glad that is not the fashion show I was just at. I was walking a little bit better that day, and it was awesome. Did you hear about the MSP Hub fashion show, entrepreneurial fashion show? They actually made us walk the pass around, you know, the walkway and all that, and I don't know, I thought it was supposed to have chicken feathers and stuff like that in my outfit, and I'm glad I didn't do that. Well, it's a high energy day. It's been really great to spend the whole day here. It's so nice to see so many familiar faces. Thanks for CSM for bringing the whole crew out. And I'm glad that Eric is here. Eric is Per Andreasen's dad. He's the executive writer for the book. So hopefully later we'll have a presentation where Per can be part of that too. And thanks Augsburg, Mary Laurel, for organizing this with the different departments I got together and really made this happen, because it's I really connected to Augsburg in very peripheral ways, and this is a really good way to come back home. So.
All right. Yeah.
And of course, I can't even think about get started before I introduce you, Green Team, Main Street Project's executive team. And so to do that, I want to ask Julie Ristout, our COO, Chief Operating Officer. Neil Rich is our executive director or CEO. And Will behind the camera is our director of communications. So it's really. So anyway, we are here because we got a story that we have to either tell or change or retell. My life has been about storytelling, just like yours. It's just a different alternative universe of sorts. I didn't grow up in the conditions that most of you probably did. You can read it in the subtitle of the book. I mean, I was born in extreme poverty. In Guatemala, we have so many social classes that we got to the point that when I was going to school and we started to figure, well, which class do I belong to and all of that, we figured there was probably not even one for us, because the last one was poverty, and I thought, well, even that profile was still better. You know, I would rather be poor than where I was. So anyway, that tells you a little bit about where our story began, where our journey out of poverty and hunger came from, where the thinking, the outside of the box, the alternative universe that we are trying to create and the alternative story we're trying to create today comes from. And I believe that we have come to believe a certain kind of storytelling, and we have embraced and now own a certain kind of storytelling that is shaping the way we grow up, the way we understand the world, and the way we actually as adults become active in that world, and it isn't good. And in this whole process, what I noticed is that even from the beginning of all of this work we do with agriculture, I was trying to figure out ways to teach this alternative way of doing things, and it never quite fit until we started telling the stories. And then we started going back and figuring out, well, listen, you know, when I started talking to my kids about our upbringing in Guatemala and tried to connect them back to their roots, I started doing that through storytelling. And so the Green Man came out of all of that process, out of the bringing up, you know, growing up in a situation where I needed a kind of alter ego, a place to go for answers where nobody wanted to or could provide answers for. Questions that you will read in the book if you haven't read it. The questions that you couldn't even ask. Like, why were all the young people being picked up in our village? And why out of the 250 of us around my age, only about 16 or 20 of us actually got to be adults? Why the rest of them got returned to our villages in body bags? Right, so we got to bury a lot of those kids, and You could not ask those questions. You could go to the funerals, just stand there and just watch the whole process and go and bury people, but you couldn't ask questions because somebody was always listening. And if you started asking questions, then they wanted to know why, and then the chain went back, and then pretty soon you were the one in the body bag. So we grew up with those stories, but at the same time, on the other side of that spectrum, you have to survive, right? So we created narratives. We created our own stories, and this is where the Green Man sort of fictional character came out of. Because I had to ask, as a kid, you know, as a 4 or 5, in that case, 7-year-old or so, watching all of that, who do you ask? If the adults won't answer your questions, if the teachers won't even dare touch the issue, who do you ask? Well, I ask Green Man. Simple as that. And that was my own thing. I would retreat to my space, and funny enough, late now, you know, in my modern days, I have come to encounter a lot of adults now that had similar experiences when they lived in traumatized conditions as children. It doesn't matter where they came from. And then last night I learned that Green Man is actually very popular in Ireland, it's also in England, and all over the place. I thought, heck, maybe we're hitting something big here. So I will go through some stuff here that relates to our story with regenerative agriculture. But I wanted to start with that sort of rounding up of some of the content in the book, some of that storytelling from the book, especially the power of storytelling in terms of educating young generations. We can't keep repeating this perennial story that a lot of children are growing up with today. Especially, we can't keep telling the stories of how bad things are. And that is all you hear anywhere you go. If we allow that to penetrate so far down into the psyche of our children, that's what they were going to be acting up when they are adults. And that's the part that scares me the most when I think of the new generations coming up. Because somehow, today's generation is acting out the stories they grew up with, if you notice that. So what I feel, and this is what I was talking to in the classroom, is that we have this, in my mind anyway, I have this wall. On this side is the US the way I experienced it, and the way I experience it now. I came in 1992, and believe me, it was dizzying trying to figure out where things belong, where things fit. I've always been an analyst, so I always wanted to see how things flow, where do I belong, how do I fit, and all of that. And to encounter that, almost anywhere you wanted to go, there was a place already predefined for you. And everybody knew this story to tell around that predefined space where you belong. If you got ideas, it's all good, but you know, we already have those ideas anyway. So once in a presentation, I talked about this new way of doing agriculture, and a fellow just says, well, listen, dude, start speaking that way. We already got a perfectly fine agricultural system. It's already predefined. The story, it's already there. We tell those stories, we tell them to ourselves, we come to believe it, and then we act them. And that's how we end up really screwed up today, in so many different ways. And it is our responsibility to change that story. And that's what we are trying to do with the book, with our work, with our team, with every community we touch, and every place we go. Now, on the other side of that wall is what I call our alternative universe, the Green Man universe, the Green Man reality, where we get to build these new stories. And that new story, in the context of how we grow food, and how we re-empower communities, and how we redesign and re-engineer the way we work in tandem with nature and everything around it, is that space we're gonna be addressing a little bit today. So again, this is the beginning of a new way of telling stories. It's the beginning of a new story. It's a whole new narrative. It won't line up with what you experience if you come from the conventional system especially. If you're a conventional thinker, this is a place where you're gonna have to force yourself to get outside of that, and at least for the next 2 hours, live in the other side of that wall. Because we live in this world on this side, yes, but there is a whole world on this other side, and it's more beautiful, and it's way better, and it's way more encouraging, and it's way more abundant. Nobody goes hungry in this other space. Nobody's poor in this other space. And it is not fictitious. It's absolutely as real as the fact that you're sitting in a chair right now. So there are certain lessons in life that I live by. The first one is this following of natural paths. Living in poverty. So think about it for a second. If you have read the book, you will find the actual descriptive language of all of this. You are in the middle of a rainforest. You get a few months to grow things. The rest of the time is raining or it's dry and so on. You get a crop of beans, corn, squash, and if it rots because it's too wet, too bad. You're going to go hungry and so on, right? In the middle of all of that, we had to figure out a way to make things last all the way through or find a way to find new kinds of foods as the cycles went on. I mean, how many of you have been exposed to this eating with the seasons concept? Now, how many people are actually willing to change their lifestyle so that they can live that way? We didn't have a choice. We had to follow natural paths to do that, right? But not only that, one of the things that we learned out of that is that if you follow natural paths, it's a lot more efficient on everything. It's a lot more abundant. Food is a lot better for you too, because our bodies, guess what? They also evolved with nature. We are not somehow removed from it. So we adapt better, we are healthier, and so on and so forth, and especially, we are happier. And when you're happy, it won't matter too much if you are poor materially. So patience was critical, because in our conditions, we may have a pound of beans and 2 pounds of corn or 10 pounds of corn left, and we were hungry. And it's so easy to just put it in the pot, cook it, and eat it. Yet we couldn't do that. Because if we did that, we wouldn't have the seed to plant the next harvest. And if you look at it, out of a single kernel, a single bean, this is data we collect, by the way. A single bean, you put it in the ground, and you get a plant that produces you from 125 to 135 beans. Now think of, if you are an economist, think of return on investment. If you take a corn kernel, and you put it in the ground, think about a regular size corn cob with 18 rows and up to 25, 30 corns per row. That's how nature multiplies energy. And that is inefficient, because corn and beans are not even the most effective way to use nature. And even there you see a miracle beyond imagination. But to be able to see the result from that, you have to be patient. Especially if you're talking about perennial foods that actually secure you food-wise for a long time. That doesn't happen with annual crops, that happens with perennial crops, nuts and things like that that produce every year without you having to intervene that much. Wisdom has to do with being able to make the difference between where you're going to have to be patient, and where you're going to have to save for the next. And being able to combine those so that you can actually live in that natural rhythm we're talking about. And then finally, there is something about the way you think about the issues that you are confronting that is critical. We always say, think systems first, think projects next. Don't start with a project and then try to see if it fits in a system. Most of the time you won't. Number one, because you're going to engineer it improperly. So if you design a whole system first, then you can actually shape and engineer projects. And you will see that through our blueprint as we look into this whole concept of how do we set up large-scale systems that are regenerative, that feed everyone, take very little space, and can be done forever. So another huge piece that we have to understand in the context of the book is that we grew up poor, yes, but poor in the eyes of other people. I use that terminology because I figured it will grab you. But the truth is, we never thought of ourselves as either poor or rich or anything like that. We didn't even know the definition of it. Eventually, we came to learn some of that. We just felt like we were happy all the time. I mean, I talked about when we moved to the rainforest after a drought killed our crop in the eastern part of the country where we were living. We had to move to a place that at least had water. That was the only criteria my dad used. And the rainforest had, except they had too much, and we didn't know how to deal with the extra humidity, so we lost some crops because of that. Yet, in the middle of all of that, the rainforest was still almost untouched. And as a kid, our playground were the canopies of trees. I mean, if you had taken a video, if Will had been there, You would have thought we were monkeys, seriously. Honestly. We were not afraid of it. We fell down a lot of times, 30 feet from the top, and the mulch on the ground was so thick that we never even broke a bone. That's how beautiful it was. And to me, that was the best blessing anybody could grow up with. Imagine if we could raise kids that way today, what would they think of nature and the world? I mean, the whole different story they will be telling today if we could have preserved those conditions so that the generations could, that the future generations could enjoy them. So, talking about poverty is a very delicate issue. We always talked about poverty in our work as not the absence of resources, but the way resources are extracted and then deteriorated and degenerated to the point that some people have nothing and others have all of it. That's the definition of poverty. It's not the lack of resources. The resources are always there. So one thing we learned was between the material poverty and the spiritual poverty, we had to find a balance. If you are spiritually rich, you can handle a lot of economic wealth. But if you are spiritually poor, wealth will make you immensely poor. Material wealth. Examples of that we have in this country is the 1%. Spiritually very poor individuals and families who live miserable lives, and there's a lot of evidence to point out to that. Yet, they are the ones with the most material wealth. So why would you want that? The only reason you would want that is because you don't understand what it means to be spiritually rich. Because the real happiness is on the other end of the spectrum. And yes, you need some money, but to go for that as the only purpose in life, that's the big mistake we have made. And so now we come to tell this other story about poverty, where somehow the rich who enrich themselves and the privileged, who are privileged because of the rest of the population, came to tell themselves the story that it is also their responsibility to go and fix the conditions of the poor. So now we also have that other big issue here where not only is the privilege already beyond what it should be, but all the privilege is being added on top, including the privilege to go and fix this for other people. So what I wanted to say from the beginning was, we didn't get out of poverty because somebody came to fix it for us. And yes, it would have been absolutely amazing and so incredible if those who wanted to intervene in our communities would have had this much wisdom and could have seen the wealth we already had. And instead of coming and making us dependent on their ideas and their way of thinking and their own narrative and their own story, they could have understood that the way out of poverty was already there and that all they needed was to continue to work with us so we could get from under, especially in that case, for our specific case, the amazing, overpowering force of the US military support of the Guatemalan army. That's all we needed. If that could be removed, we would have thrived. We're one of the wealthiest communities in the world. If you go to Guatemala, you have been there, you will see them. But yet we have this other narrative that other people have grown up with that says that America is for the Americans and that every resource around here is to be owned and controlled so that you can grow wealth, the American dream, right? So that is the true story behind poverty. And it is not our story of poverty and how you get out of it. Our story of how you move from poverty into food security and hope is spiritually based. And it has the natural paths behind it. And today, a whole system framework that we are trying to implement so that story gets reproduced and we can create this other universe that is so tangible, so possible, and so much more beautiful. So, people, nature, and agriculture. We have changed so many times in the history of the world because of food and agriculture. And I propose, and at the end of the book, you'll find that statement, that we can reinvent how we live on the basis of how we grow our food, just like it has happened in the past. To understand that, you gotta understand chickens. Number one, chickens are not pasture animals. They are, in any case, to the contrary, the opposite. chickens are also, if you are thinking about regenerative agriculture, chickens are the only livestock option that is universal, that can reinvent our story from our communities that no other livestock can. If you look at, say, pigs, you look at cattle should be grazed on grasses, right? Yet, if you look at the whole globe, you will find that very specific pockets are only fit for that kind of animal. Yet, in regeneration language, in the science behind regenerative, the regenerative nature of design, you have to have livestock to create the inoculation points where the biodynamics, their microflora and fauna, is re-injected into the system so that it can regenerate itself and go for another full cycle of energy and produce more food for us. And if you're going to disrupt the conventional system and not do it just because you don't like it, protest it. If you're going to actually disrupt it for the end purpose of taking its space and re-engineering a whole system, you have to start with one livestock option, one entry point that has the maximum ripple effect, and it can actually not only disrupt the economics and the structures of discrimination, all of that, and injustice, but more importantly, it can unite all of the farmers in the world, especially small farmers under 5 hectares of land that produce 70% of our food worldwide. And there is no other livestock option that can do that but the chicken. So next time you see a chicken, you better bow to it. My chicken is just that. Now, one thing about chicken is it's a jungle. It's a jungle animal. So as a jungle animal, just imagine the possibilities of the storytelling that can come out from this. The conventional system can take our system and make it big and produce a lot of chicken the same way we do. But one thing is impossible. And that's our story. Because our story is one where we pre-build these jungle spaces where the chicken evolved over geological time, which is more in alignment with those hundreds of thousands of families in the world that produce 70% of our food, and where nobody, no matter how small their plot is, can enter the system. That's a story that not only goes counter to the traditional storytelling of the conventional system, is more efficient, is decentralized, is really powerful, and it builds the most important component of systems redesign, which is the social cohesiveness that is critical for us to win anything. Money, organizing, protesting, and all of that is one thing. But if we can come together as communities and we can take one thing away, we only need to have one huge system level win for the rest of it to follow. And that's why we pick chickens. And that's why we go work with them the way we do. We have known about them for over 10,000 years. The British have data back to up to 17,000 years ago. So yes, we can use the green man abilities to observe and to relearn how the chicken grew and all of that, but we also have a lot of data from the scientists, so we can combine those two and come up with a really powerful proposition where we get to reintegrate the incredible diversity that still exists. I mean, out of all the animal livestocks in the world, chicken is the one that hasn't yet succumbed to the genetic manipulation and to degenerative nature of scientific thinking of today. So, we can still take this resource and, like we did as kids, bring back a whole new way of thinking about how we feed the world. Following nature paths means at a system level of thinking that we engage in a whole new way of engineering. And this is where the actual technical parts start to take shape. The way we went about this is actually pretty straightforward. Now, if I show you the whole slide, it'll probably make you dizzy. For 1 second, just clean up your mind. Don't think too much about anything else, but this very simple fact. The food that you just ate is a whole combination, is a really large-scale cocktail of chemical elements that you just put in your body. Those same elements were just maybe, I hope, a few days ago, not months ago, in a field somewhere. Those chemical elements were in the soil. If you follow the biology and the natural flow of energy in nature, you will know that 80% of what you ate didn't come from the soil, it actually came from the air, especially atmospheric carbon, nitrogen, and so on and so forth. And not only that, but in its original form, the way it was in the field, if you had taken those elements and eaten them, it would have killed you. Some of it is so poisonous you can't even touch this material. Yet, you put it through a process of transformation, and at the end you get carrots and all these other things that we can eat and be happy with. Now, how does that happen? Over billions of years, nature created these absolutely amazing, sophisticated, super efficient ways of transforming energy from unedible energy to edible energy so that we all could have food where we live. Every ecology has the capacity to do that. And every ecology has some kind of livestock, animal, or whatever, wild or not, domesticated or not, that actually makes those cycles complete and keeps them going. And they were going on for, what, 60 billion years before we intervened and said, oh, we know better how to do that, right? And this, so we are at a point now where we can't go back that far, but we don't have to become, we don't have to be so backwards that we start putting animals in concentration buildings so that we take, you know, all of this absolutely amazing landscape that used to dominate the center of the country and turn it into corn and soybean fields. Seriously, I mean, when you look at what was there and how unimaginably efficient and productive that was, and we come and do that to it, right? So where does that come from? It's a story that was built over time. It was told to those kids before they actually got into those combines and those tractors. They became to believe that as the narrative of their lives and their purpose for being. Now we gotta change that. So here's one way to change that. Okay, we can go back all the way back, but we don't want to continue what we're doing today. It's already proven is a train wreck coming to us. First of all, think of energy again. You take an energy. In our case, we're talking about poultry-centered systems. Again, you know, for the reasons I explained before. If you take that energy, we look at it as poultry feed or poultry food if you're using whole grains and things like that. You take that into a free-ranging system that we have designed with some pretty sophisticated agronomics and science behind it. You take that and you capture all of that 80% of that energy that is free for the taking. Now you can do that in our system because we got these paddocks that we have planted with a lot of other plants, and especially in Minnesota, perennial crops like hazelnuts and elderberries and sugar maples and oaks and so on and so forth, that actually can capture a lot more of that energy on the basis of the ground energy that the poultry is depositing in the paddocks. So when you harvest, you're not just harvesting one thing, but you're harvesting multiple outputs. So in this case, we're looking at a baseline of meat, eggs, hazelnuts, and elderberries just to get started. Now, this is the same energy that came in the form of feed, plus all of the other energy that was there ready to be taken if we just play with natural paths. And then bring it into the paddock where we have the chickens roaming around to get this harvest, and then we get all of these byproducts, you know. Especially we get, with this system, we get to filter water, clean the water, we get to extract all of those extra nutrients, we keep them from going into the ground, keeping from them going down the ditch or up into the air and all of that. So, and yet we are producing superior eggs and superior quality meat. From a market perspective, you can't beat this. Seriously, from a taste perspective, you can't beat this. Now, we got excess energy, and remember, whenever you have excess energy in a system, you either put it into a cycle that follows that natural path, or it becomes a pollutant. It becomes a pollutant, it's a problem. It doesn't matter if it's organic certified or synthetic. If you put, you know, nitrates into this glass of water, it'll be almost just the same. Doesn't matter if it's organic. That's the key to natural chemicals. So if you get this excess energy, then we get, you know, most of the time, most of that energy is in the form of manure, although we get giblets and feathers too. This high in phosphorus, one of the key elements of life, life linking elements, phosphorus, potash, and also nitrogen, the manure is primarily about 40% nitrogen, and the rest of it is a lot of minerals. So you want to remineralize your vegetables, you put this raw materials that came out of Success Energy out of all of this process already, you move it into a space outside of the paddocks, and now you got a whole new set of harvests. And again, as you go into this, you can expand the hazelnuts and the elderberries into non-paddock production. Means we are talking now about acreage. Hundreds of acres if you want, thousands of acres if you want. It's up to our communities how we want to envision this and what we want to write this new story. Now, we can grow everything that was sitting here on the table, everything that was served at lunch today can be grown as a result of that. And guess what? All of this is still the energy that came in the beginning, plus the energy that was absorbed in the process back into the same system again. And not only that, but every time you turn the circle, you get to put some of that energy back into the same poultry system to the point that I can bet whatever you want, in the next 10 years, we will be able to create fully enclosed systems where the energy just goes on and on the way nature designed it. And out of each process, because we are gaining so much energy to the natural phenomena that happens to the principles of thermodynamics, that we will be able to feed everyone and never bring in an ounce of inputs. That is regenerative agriculture engineering in a nutshell. And we can do this, and we can do that, because there are green men out there who know all this stuff. And all you have to do is learn to listen again. And all we have to do is migrate from this side of the wall to this other side of the world. And I know this is not news to you, because most of you already know we have to do that. All we have done is assemble a team so that we can build a blueprint, a path, a chisel and a hammer, so that we can open up cracks in that wall and people can start moving on to the other side. Bottom line is, we don't need confinement animal production. We need very little space plowed and turned over to produce other things. We need more. We can restore most of the ecological landscape and feed ourselves abundantly, efficiently, and do it forever. That's the foundation of this design. Now, we can do a lot of other things once we start moving this into the production landscape. One thing we know we can start with is the reorganizing and transforming of existing small farms. So Will Crombie is here because, number one, he's our communications director, but he also is part of a family farm, 42 acres south of Northfield. And we have kind of gotten together and we have redesigned that farm to reflect this engineering process. We just, as Main Street Project, just secured 100 acres next to my house, where we're going to deploy 100 acres as what we're calling the central farm, which will become the pivoting point from which we can train farmers in the whole southeastern Minnesota region, so that we can deploy a whole regional landscape with this new design. So again, it's not pie in the sky anymore. We can do that. We can also launch and grow new farmers. New farmers who are coming into the landscape now don't have to try to figure out how they fit into the conventional narrative. We got a new narrative already. We can just become part of that. And yes, it's risky, and yes, Tony can tell you, it's a lot of work, and Will too, and all of us can tell you, but isn't it more work on the other side anyway? And don't you just get peanuts for the work you put into it? On this side, at least you get a heck of a return. And I will go into all of those details. I just wanted to make that point. Patience, again, the perennial jungle environments don't happen overnight. And if they are the cornerstone of our system, we have to be patient as we go through. And that requires patient investors, patient farmers, patient professionals, and on it goes. This is an example of a place in Colombia that we have been called to look into on the basis of this same blueprint. Just to give you a perspective on how we can take this same storytelling process, the same narrative, the same engineering, and take steep landscapes that have been for decades opium fields in Colombia, where people figured out that if they they could do poultry, they could feed themselves because opium wasn't feeding them. It was creating a lot of chaos in the community and violence and all of that. And so we came in and started to look at what they already had and started to redesign the landscape here so we could stop this slash and burn. We started to restore it. You know, they already have some perennial crops. They were not paying attention to that. We created a whole new print, and now they have one production unit that they are redesigning so they can start training. In this case, up to, you know, 1,000 indigenous families in this region. Just look at that. This is Michael Abelman, a photographer out of California, wrote a book where he put pictures of farmers all over the place, and he said in Peru and Colombia, farmers are known to fall off their fields. Well, this is an example. He was not exaggerating. If you slip here, you will stop all the way, you know, until you get down somewhere here. This is 23,000 hectares independent territory, already owned and controlled by the Ingas, that they where they remove opium as part of the culture. And started growing other things, yet they didn't know what to do with this. They started clear cutting and putting corn and beans. Again, those same mistakes we made as kids in the rainforest, and now we are in time to be able to come back and say, you don't have to do that. In fact, it won't feed you, and it will keep you in poverty. That is corn and soybean, that's what the gringos do. That's how we talk about it. So, if you think systems first and projects second, you gotta start with the lighthouses or the principles. The lighthouses that will guide us every time there is something difficult to deal with, we go back to one area that grounds how we're gonna make decisions on that. Whether it's being fair to everybody in the system, fair to consumers by not overpricing products, fair to workers by not exploiting them, and so on, to transparency so that we can all be part of the governance structures, whether it's sustainable from the standpoint of economics, purely economics. Sustainability has nothing to do with nature, that's just economics. Nature has to do with resiliency. Resiliency in the context of, in our context of regenerative agriculture, is the process by which a organism becomes able to resist, to recuperate, and to rebound from shock. That doesn't happen because something is sustainable. It happens because something is resilient. Resilient is the result in organisms, is the result of a geoevolutionary process. We can't breed resiliency into a plant. That's the narrative that we have been told again, the storytelling of the industry, so that we shut up and be quiet about the real solutions. So that's why we use resiliency. And that's why we use hazelnuts, because hazelnuts, in the context of the geological blueprint of this landscape we're standing on, they are some of the most resilient plants, and they produce beautiful, highly nutritious food. In fact, with hazelnuts, you can eliminate most of the vegetables we ate today. And not that you want to do that, but if you wanted to, if you had to, for food security purposes, we could do that. Bottom line is, nobody's gonna go malnourished because we did that, right? And hazelnuts can do that, elderberries can do that too, and so on and on. H ecology developed its own blueprints based on thousands and millions of years of ecological events that shape the genetic makeup of each one of the organisms that evolve up in that specific ecology. And that's what's called resiliency. You can't breed it into. Humankind is, number one, is too stupid to understand all of those things that we have absolutely, practically demonstrated already. Not only that, but the stupidity doesn't come from our lack of ability to actually understand those processes, because we can. Our stupidity comes from our inability to balance out our greed with our spirituality. That's where the problem is. If we can balance that out, we could make way more use of all of the intellect that is out in the world. In fact, we always say that what we are missing in this world today, and this is the reason I chose to write this book instead of the technical manual for growing poultry. The reason I did this book is because what we are missing isn't knowledge and technical skills on how to do things. We could geoengineer anything you want right now. We got the technology. What we are missing is purpose and values. That's what we are missing. And without purpose and values, we professionals become the ones that destroy everything that is valuable. And now all the technology that is all good. So you see, that's how we ended up with CAFOs, confinement animal feeding operations, because there is no values in that. The only thing that that pursues is maximum output and maximum potential profit. And in the way, it renders the efficiency ineffective because it's one of the least effective energy transformation systems. And on the other hand, reduces the economic returns to such a point that everybody is one little, you know, glitch away from going broke anyway. So what's the purpose of doing that? It's actually stupidity, but I just don't have any other more sophisticated way of saying that. You know? So you take those principles and you focus them on a triple bottom line return, and then you can move into actually building prototypes that respond to that. So here what you have is the hazelnuts in the middle, the chickens on the bottom of all of these canopies with heavy application of straw, so that you can balance out the nitrogen in the manure from the chicken with the microbial activity so that there is a 20-to-1 roughly ratio, or at least you don't go, you know, out of whack, so that that nitrogen is never gonna end up in your water or turn into ammonia and go up in the air. The other thing is that while the perennial crops develop, we get to plant, you know, other kind of annual crops, in this case, native Guatemalan corn that we can make food out of, or sunflowers, you know, they're harvested on the next slide. Sunflowers that were planted on the other side of the hazelnut rows, and then these are growing elderberry rows here. Both of them really ecologically adapted to the poultry underneath. And if you don't know too much about agriculture, remember, a chicken shit can kill a lot of things. It's not as benign as you think. You have to pick carefully which plants you combine, because not all of them evolved to live in tandem with chickens. Now, hazelnuts, at this point, we are outproducing almost every one of the 500 hazelnut growers in the Midwest by about 4 times. And the chickens have weeded and fertilized them. We go in and we harvest them all right. And if you go and check them right now, we have about twice as many cattails, flowers, this spring than we had last year. And last year we outproduced every producer by 4 times. The previous year we were producing by 2 times. I don't know, maybe there is a limit to this. I hope there isn't, because this is way too exciting. The foundation of the blueprint of the unit of production is pretty simple. You get a building. In Minnesota, we have a solarium because we get winter here and chickens don't like to be cooped up. So the solarium allows us to bring them in a spring-like environment during the 30 below degree weather and stuff. But if it's 40, even in the middle of the winter with, you know, not too deep snow, in the deep snow, they flop and then they can't go anywhere because they open up holes. So anyway, the key to the management is the paddocks. Paddocks divided into two, where we can rotate them back and forth while one side regenerates, we have them on the other side, and then we'll move them back when the other side regenerates and so on. Meat birds are much more flexible in terms of how you can manipulate the nutrient pellets and stuff, because you can stop and delay the next flock and so on. Egg layers are a little bit more intricate. The units differ in size and specs based on whether you're going to do egg layers or meat birds. With the production unit figured out, we can move into larger scale designs. This is the farm at Will's place, 42 acres, 5 production units for egg layers in the south, 10 paddocks. This we planted last year with 19,000 hazelnuts. And the lower part is also already planted closer together. So this will be managed for a multi-story canopy. This is where the poultry will be. And this is where the extra manure will be utilized to make all of these 42 acres productive. I'll show you how the numbers pan out at the end of the day. This is that design in actual, you know, once was planted. So if we want to think systems, for a second imagine a plant, a processing plant in Faribault that runs about 1.6 million chickens a week. We were offered a 1-hour little shift in one conventional plant. And what we needed to come up was 50,000 birds to run them through 1 hour of time at the beginning of their shift. That's conventional agriculture right there. Now, the bottom line is that there is nothing wrong with doing things efficient like that. Once you took the birds out of the fields, there's no point in spending too much time in processing them. Yet, to make it regenerative, you want to involve a whole other set of principles, especially the governance issue. And most important than anything else is the ownership and control. Because when someone isn't taking everything away, you got a lot more to share. When you got a lot more to share, people are willing to do things slower. You can downsize those plants and still be just as profitable, and so on and so forth. So as we think large scale, here's the foundation of it. The key isn't in building large single operations. It's in the integration of the free-range poultry with the eggs, with the meat processing, with the grain processing, with the grain production. In other words, what the industry has done is vertically integrate everything. There is no need for us to reinvent that. Yet, what we are reinventing or restructuring here is who owns and controls this. As long as there is no single ownership and control, it doesn't matter that we are utilizing conventional methodology for the mechanical parts. You see, this is where a lot of back to the land folks made a big mistake. It's like they want to be in the ground doing things with their hands and all that. There's no need for that. The industry already invented pretty good systems. We just got to transfer them to the other side of the wall where the ownership and control is different. And so if you integrate everything, and again, we're still talking about poultry, you can bring in from 14 to 20 enterprise sectors to the point that the productivity or the output of the whole system becomes just this massive amount of resources that turn over and over and over. And when you turn things over, instead of extracting things, they always increase in value. That's the beauty of coming out of poverty. Once you remove the extractive nature of conventional systems, everybody can live pretty well. There is plenty to go around. So as we look at this, and thinking of the Central Farmer Main Street project, the idea was to move from the unit prototypes that I showed you and that you can come and visit anytime you want, to the farm level, which we are doing now through the farm south and to the central farm, to then move to the regional system, I'll show you in a second what that means, to institutionalization, which means we hope universities and colleges are gonna start teaching this as their narrative for the future generations. And so we can tell a whole new story about what is actually doable on the other side of the wall. To do this, we focused on the southeastern part of the state. We set a target for 5% of the state's meat and eggs, which represents roughly this kind of numbers. We calculated that under our design and according to the how many units we put per farm, we need around 153 farms, again, to meet these goals, and about 3,570 acres. Keep in mind that some industrial farms are 4, 6, and 10,000 acres. So this is tiny, tiny, tiny. Yet we could produce up to $74 million worth of value for the farm community under a design like that, just on the basis of the replicability and the adding of value of the resources that already exist in those communities. When we compare this to a conventional system output, the same space under a conventional system with corn and soybeans around this gross income per acre, which is, this is in a good year, in a good year we could get up to $4.28 million out of that same landscape. We can get up to $74 million out of that same landscape. Not only that, but we got economic, ecological, and social regeneration at the same time that we generate up to 8 times more value. To this $428 million, we would have to subtract the ecological, economic, and social damage that conventional systems cause to the point that this would be negative about 25 cents on the dollar. That's what the Rural Policy Research Institute found out was the case for the southern 36 counties of Minnesota. So this is not rocket science. The other side of the wall is not idealistic, is not pipe dream, is so real, so doable. You can come and look at it if you don't believe it. It's already partially done. We just gotta get together now and reinvent our narrative together. Because if we don't do that, listen, all of those chickens are really unhappy. So we really have to do this for the chickens, you know. So we, you know, once we had this, we started getting calls from all over the place. So we went to Pine Ridge because they invited us to bring this ideology, this way of engineering to their area. This spring, they're about to get the first block in the training site there. We built this site in San Miguel de Allende that, you know, you heard mentioned. It's already highly productive. It's really nicely run. We built a rainery. Because it doesn't rain very much there, we built the water collection system. We use it all rainwater for the system. The granary has the capacity to process about 29 million pounds of grain, which puts us right in front of about 300 small farms in that area. So it's really promising. We started a national movement in Guatemala. It was called the Chicken Revolution by the Social Lab. It's this initiative out of Chile. Was introduced to Guatemala, and they picked our system as the centerpiece of the launch of Social Lab Guatemala. And we are now mapping out, four nucleuses in the north, the south, the east, and the highlands, so that we can bring those communities together to deploy this kind of system. Luckily for us in Guatemala, we never went over the cliff like in the US, where pretty much all of the heritage breeds were kind of put to the side. In Guatemala, the industry owns around 25 million laying hens, while backyard chickens, mostly under the control of women, are over 36 million. So over 11 million more than the industry itself. So actually, it is real. It's really a chicken revolution. So we spent some time in Colombia this last year, and we organized a team of 10 professionals there to get that moving. We also working directly with Zamorano School of Agriculture to deploy another training site there so we can start training agronomists who are graduating there. And we're in the middle of a process with a group in Haiti that Neil made contact in Washington. I went to visit them last year and looks very promising, and there's no place I have ever visited that needs more food than Haiti. And it was really, back to my history with poverty and all that, I really didn't know what to say when I went there, because I was ready to go and live the way I grew up, and I told our guide it was not a problem. He said, we're going to a poor community and all that. I said, don't worry. Yet we got there and I thought, oh yeah, gotta worry about this one. So if you walk with any message today, it should be that. Again, the book is simply stepping outside of the box, stepping outside of the narrative we have been raised with, and inventing the narrative of the future that we want to see. The future of today didn't just happen. It was engineered, it was designed, it was deliberately built the way it is, it was deliberately surrounded with protective policies and an industry and capital and institutions that teach it. It didn't just happen out of thin air. In the same way, if you want to see it differently, you got to engineer it, support it, build it, and make it happen. That's the only way we're going to write a different story when it's time to do the next book.